down when they get it back.
So they kill it too? Hey, y'all. Yeah. Are you here for the slice for you?
My name is Howard Eugene Allen. I'm a descendant of the original white settler in Jackson Township. He built water mills on the Patoka, 100% water mills. And I have pictures of his work here. My maternal grandfather, great-grandfather, bought the old Cap Swift place, which was between Elon and Newton Stewart. And I have some pictures of the old building, the old house that Cap Swift built. He was the commander of the Jackson Township contingent of the Civil War. And he brought a Negro back with him that took care of his horses, and he liked to race horses. That's a side story to what I'm telling. And my grandfather Morgenroth bought the property when Cap Swift lost it in a horse race gambling deal. And that's when my grandfather took over. He was a young man born in 1890 in 1904 when they came onto this property in Orange County out of Du Bois, around Snellville.
Talk a little bit about your family in Du Bois County.
Well, about all I know is that they came from my great-great-grandfather's buried there at Snellville next to the church, great big monument. But his son George.
What was his name?
George S. Morgenroth was the one that came into Orange County bringing his family when my grandfather was like 10, 12 years old, 14 years old, I guess.
Yeah. From 1990 to 1904.
Yeah. And granddad was a really strong, strapping fella, and he kind of helped his father when they got into. My great grandfather got into moving the machinery off of the river that my paternal grandfather had built. And this is the wreckage of it. He had built it originally by cutting a great big tree down through and taking out the middle slab real thick and leaning it up across a gravel bar edgeways and creating a dam and a current off to the side where he built a undershoot water mill. It turned backwards. Instead of running over the top, it turned backwards and run his mill. And this is what it looked like from a picture that someone else had. And this is some Blanchard Cope family that whose mother is pictured here. I gave him a picture of it before he died, and he identified her. And it's somewhere along here where they had a wedding picture taken. And my grandfather on my maternal side moved the gears up in Newton Stewart and put them in this building here and run added diesel to it to run the gears. And he got in trouble on the.
What was he milling there?
Grain for local farmers, and he got in debt. People not being able to pay their bills during the Depression. Uh-huh. And he also owned, in Crawford County, he owned at Eckerdy, he owned the mill there for 6 months, and I've got an abstract deed for that. This is another picture of an old log building that was in the vicinity between Elon and Newton Stewart, actually between Granddad's farm and Newton Stewart, where we, when I was a boy, well, we went over on the mules pulling an old log wagon and so on. Sometimes to take an old mid to late mid 30s case tractor, row crop tractor, about run real slow, you know, in high gear. And they pull the wagon, we go over there, do the trading. At that time, Omar Osborne owned the store and operated it in Newton Stewart. And I went to school at Eland, and there was a general store there owned by Lloyd Drake at the time that I remembered and had been for several years. But I remember the old building.
Anybody know where that's at?
This is my grandfather, raised five daughters in a two-room house.
And the
second from the right is my mother. The oldest to, from the left, the oldest to the youngest. My mother was second to the right. She's the second to the youngest.
And what year was she born?
I think it was 1918. Yeah. And this is my maternal grandfather and mother. He didn't have any boys, so he kind of took me over, and I was with him before this picture.
Going, is that you there?
Yeah, he'd take me to the field on this old tractor here. And this is a later picture of me and a couple of cousins from Louisville. But he'd put me on, stand up here, and he'd be disking with him. And if I got sleepy, I'd lay down on the floorboard, and he'd put a foot behind me to keep me from falling off in the disc. But I have the fondest memories of growing up with him.
And what's your flask here? We're getting it.
All right, now I'm going to tell you about that. He gave that to me, and he said, Howard, this came over with the first Morgenroths on a sailing ship. One of them was a High Dutch, and one of them was a Low Dutch. They just got married, and he was coming to the New World. And the woman got struck by lightning on the ship on the way over, but she lived to raise a family. And he said, they brought cases of these with them. This was, and from the best research I've done, which is very poor, they were developed by the Germans that were mercenaries in wars with the Romans and others over in there. And they got the Phoenician craft ideas that brought them back and built their kilns down in the ground, and they made glass and used it for a practical purpose, where the Phoenicians used it for the very rich and decorative, more or less. But Granddad dug a basement in this old house, and they were stored in there. And when it started burning, from it still had a shingle roof that caught fire up here and was burning down. And I can remember seeing my mother standing here throwing furniture off out of the house with flames behind her. Dad got to her and got her out just in time. But the old house burnt down, and as he come up out of the basement, he had these boxes with him, and I didn't know what they were till he gave me one of them and told me that he said that he was saving them because they came across the ocean on a sailing ship with the first Morgenroth family in our line, or his line. And there was flaming timbers bouncing off his shoulders as he carried them out. I can remember seeing through the house, seeing that happen. They had some little baby chicks broodering in a back room, and they were running all over the place.
And where was this house located?
Between Elon and Newton Stewart. There was no dirt road through there. Actually, it came from French Lick out of the north up over the ridge where Granddad lived, an old two-room house, and I ain't got a picture of that with me. And then it come down the hill east and then turned south and went toward Newton Stewart. And across the big branch down there, but it's no dirt road. When I was growing up, we were still riding fenders of cars and shooting rabbits at night off the headlights.
You know where South Liberty Cemetery is?
Yeah.
My father and grandfather and grandmother is buried out there.
Well, that's where I've spent, raised my kids. And spent my, I'm an elder out there.
That's where Dad was raised up.
What was the name?
Roberts. Clinton Roberts.
Roberts, okay.
Christopher Roberts was his dad.
Yeah. You been out there lately?
Yeah, just the other day I went past there.
Yeah, they've got it in pretty good shape.
Yeah.
Cemetery. Yeah, I'm glad to meet you.
Dad was a veteran of World War I.
Yeah.
I'm a Korean War veteran.
Yeah.
So how old were you when the fire took place?
It was in about the middle of the later 40s, maybe 47, 48. Mm-hmm. Somewhere around there, and then we moved into the house on the other farm that Granddad had come in. The federal land bank come around 1942, and they were repossessing lands that had been financed through the federal land bank. Uh-huh. And they offered Granddad the one that he was actually living on in between them, his Granddad and the other farm. And Granddad had been kind of sharecropping the rest of them, and he said, no. He said, I want them all or none. So they sold him 444 acres for about $7,200 to $7,500, something like that. And he went around just with his britches rolled up, union suit and an overalls, and that's all he ever wore hardly. And barefoot with thick soles, you could run through briar patch with a rabbit when you go and chase cows and stuff. Get on the hot pavements in town, he'd raise one foot up and grit his teeth and rub it against his leg. And it was hot, he'd finally get through to him. He's tough.
We have had quite a time with these events. It's been interesting. We have learned things that we never knew, and realized what a treasure that we have, and how some of our history is being lost by those folks not writing down some of the stories and passing those along. So it's been wonderful for those who have shared with us. We always open every session with a little history. So Roger's going to do that for us today.
And the first thing I'm going to do is confess to something that I don't know, and that's how to pronounce what looks like a simple enough name. E-L-O-N. Elon? Elon?
Elon.
Elon. Elon. All right. Well, surely I can't mess that up too much. Elon. As Imogene has talked about, we're here in Jackson Township today celebrating the township, Newton Stewart, Elon, and Ellsworth. The presence of vast land, woods, and water sources are what attracted the first residents of Jackson Township. Not to mention, there was a sense of freedom in this land. And to the first settlers arriving here, that were fleeing the oppression of slavery in the southern states, it was exactly what they were in search of. The first people in this area did not bring much with them, as their primitive travel accommodations would not allow it. They built log homes and worked with what they could. It soon became apparent that the new residents of what would become Jackson Township in Orange County needed to expand their settlement with towns that offered mills, blacksmiths, gunsmiths, and other trades. From the building of these towns along the Patoka River, the towns of Newton Stewart, Elon, and Ellsworth were brought to life in and around Orange County. Elon was a small community that thrived in the early years of Orange County. Along with Ellsworth, these two small communities were central meeting places for the people who lived in early Jackson Township. These small communities brought Orange County and its residents business and commerce for a long while. However, the two became extinct when the Patoka Lake Reservoir was constructed and completed in 1978. Along with Elon and Ellsworth, there was a town in the extreme south of the township that went by the name of Newton Stewart. This was a very prominent community in the area with many businesses that contributed to the shaping of Orange County. It was also here where a dam was built that was said to have been one of the premier sites for water power in the county. The Newton Stewart neighborhood was laid out on April 17, 1839 by William and Henry Stewart, and in a few years it became known as the third largest community in the county during the 1880s. Religion was of significant value to the early residents of Orange County. And after meeting for worship in the homes of several different families, it came time to build a church. In 1825, with volunteer labor from the community, a log church house was built, and it was called Cane Creek. This building was used until the members of the church came together and used hewn logs to construct a new building. About this time, in the 1840s, A small community had grown around the church, and John A. Weininger had established a general store there at Cane Creek. After this, population started to climb, and a third and present building was completed in 1872 using some of the hewn logs from the old church house. Improvements to the Little Country Church have since been made, but the church itself stands to remind us of the early Orange Countyans who highly regarded religion. Just 1 mile east off of State Road 145 sits South Liberty Church of Christ. This church was established later in 1869. The families of Seabolt, Rogers, Smith, and Beatty were principally instrumental in organizing this little church that is situated in the northeastern part of Jackson Township. South Liberty has truly stood the test of time and still holds services today. In the late 1800s, the railroads were quickly becoming the main form of faster transportation. When the Patoka River Valley was passed due to unruly topography, population soon dwindled in these towns. However, the influence these communities had in their prime were extremely important in making Orange County the wonderful place it is today. Flooding along the Patoka River was a big issue for the people who lived in this area, as well as in Jasper, where the Patoka River ran as well. After several years of discussion that began in the 1940s, it was finally decided in 1965 that a reservoir was going to be constructed that would soon take the name of Patoka Lake. The remaining citizens of Elon, Ellsworth, and some from Newton Stewart relocated, and the Patoka Lake Reservoir was completed in 1978. Not only does the lake provide flood control, but it also provides drinking water to 11 counties, all the while bringing commerce to the area through recreational water activities and other attractions situated around the lake. Jackson Township's amazing history is one that is vital to Orange County. Although some of the neighborhoods are extinct due to Patoka Lake, and some aren't as prosperous as they once were, they still contributed so much to our area. The lake has since become a vital part of Orange County today, bringing thousands of tourists each year to our area. We have who I think is probably the youngest person who comes almost every time and gets her passport punched, and that's my granddaughter there, who's 1 year old today. Thank you.
We have a great deal of memorabilia that is kind of spread out and around. I know that we have a binder brought here today, and that binder has all of the pictures of lots of houses and communities before the Patoka Lake was flooded, so it gives you an idea of what it looked like underneath all of the water that we have here today. Jeff is going to be making a presentation, and as I said, we have refreshments for you. So let's say in about 30 minutes, that will give you 30 minutes to get up and walk around and look around at everything that we have. I know that we've got some really interesting stories, so we will gather back in 30 minutes.
Okay. I'm going to tell them everything I know about Newton Stewart. Okay, see you. Glad you're back. Bye-bye.
I'm Aletha Luce Cooper. I was raised in Pale, Indiana, but I've lived in Jackson Township for 34 years. I have some history on my great-grandmother Hall. Had a sister that was born and raised in Elon, and her name was Polly Anna Swift. She is buried in the cemetery here at the Patoka Memorial. And I just had a lot of information on it, and I haven't got it all together, except it's interesting. I know she was buried here, and there was a man by the name of Captain Swift that was her husband's father. Mm-hmm. And if anyone had any more information they'd like to give me, it's kind of interesting. I also want to mention a lady that was a good friend of mine when we first moved here that had a memory about all the government property was purchased, and her name was Shirley Goldman, and she passed away a few years ago, but she was a delight to tell me a lot about the old homesteads and where they were located. Mainly, I think I'd just like to memorialize this lady, Pollyanna, because she was born and raised in Elon and taught school in Indianapolis, and but she was a, as I said, a sister to my great grandmother, and she, I do remember meeting her when I was younger. She was, I think she died in 1962, so I've only been 13. And at that time, I wasn't interested in all this.
Yeah. So how did you get in interested in all this?
My mother's 95, and she has a memory about a lot of her her aunts and uncles and grandparents. And this Pollyanna Swift is also, would be a cousin to Glenn Hall. So that would be another area, that another side of the family. But so I'm related to Pollyanna's sister that was my great-grandmother's. We'd like to thank Darlene and Larry for welcoming us into the cafe here. It's been here several years, and it's kind of like coming home out here. We come for coffee, and it's a nice little place to see people in the area that come in for coffee and breakfast in the mornings. And I just want to thank them for having us. It was nice. Thank you, Larry and Darlene.
And they didn't have to do that.
No, they didn't have to do this. Nice facility, air-conditioned, and yeah, like I said, it's kind of like home.
when the heat index is 105 outside, it's nice to have a place that's a little cooler to come.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
I grew up in the oldest house in Monroe County. So I, unfortunately, 69 took all of our property. They took everything and put it toward the forestry. And, you know, my grandparents' place is gone. All the, you know, people that I grew up with that had lived there for 40 years were all displaced.
So, what road was it?
37.
It's on 37?
Yeah, yeah.
We're, so we're real close to Victor Pike then.
Right,
the,
right.
The interchange came in.
Yeah, yeah. So that's, they took all the property on the east side of the highway and put it with the forestry. And then anything on the west side of the highway, they rerouted them because it being an expressway, they were going to landlock everyone, and so we wouldn't have a way to get out. So the state came in and bought everything.
So describe to someone who doesn't know where Painter Creek Cafe is.
Well, Painter's Creek Cafe is just at the top of the hill from Painter's Creek. We have a great breakfast. We have a great breakfast here, great lunch. We're open 7 days a week. The only days we're closed are Mother's Day and Easter Sunday.
Right, well, thank you so much for hosting us.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Basically, what I'm going to tell you is my connection with Jackson Township. And some people, I have some curious people. Where are you, curious person? Yes. Miss Curious, what were you asking me earlier?
Oh, which time?
Oh, the letters.
Huh?
The letters.
Yeah.
On the little coin.
Coins.
Okay, the man in the picture, who's almost ready to fall off, is my great-grandfather, Thomas Andrew Parks. The initials on the little tokens RTAP. He owned the general store at one time in Newton Stewart, and you had to, the stories that I get it are that he, if you brought in eggs, let's say, and you wanted to trade with him, he would pay you in tokens, which of course caused you to go back to his store to spend them. Or he would pay you less if you wanted government money. So it's a little interesting story I'm going to read to you from 1983 that was written by a man named Bill Bishop from the Herald staff in Jasper, I suppose. We have had these tokens in our family for many, many years. And then I was able to find a picture of my great-grandfather, and so I cut it in an oval shape to match the frame. But this is what Mr. Bishop says about these tokens. They're called rabbit checks. C-H-E-C-K-S. Says we're as plentiful as rabbits. He says, if while strolling around Patoka Lake, you happen to kick up a coin-like brass token with the letters TAP stamped on it, pick it up and run. Run, don't walk, to the Patoka Lake Visitor Center. Reservoir specialist Carol Groves will be waiting there for you. Carol Groves will be, you will make her very happy. And your name may even go down in local history because you have found a rabbit check. Love this next sentence. Not one rabbit check is known to exist today. Though there used to be hundreds, maybe thousands of them. And then Mrs. Groves writes, Patoka Lake hopes that someday she'll have even just one rabbit check to put on display. So my dad and I took three or four of different values and different shapes to her, and others since then have given them rabbit checks as well. Well, there once was a man named Thomas A. Parks, Thomas Andrew actually, Parks, who operated a store in the tiny community of Newton Stewart a long time ago. Now, Lana and David Lowe, brought a picture there in the window of what that store looked like. Their family also owned it after the Parks family. Where was I? This Mr. Parks sold everything from caskets to furniture, all your hardware, clothes, groceries, just anything you need, says Mrs. Groves, who learned about Parks and rabbit checks through a written history by Fred Dillard, who was an old man living in the vicinity of the visitor center even before there was any thought of building a Patoka Lake Visitor Center, or even a Patoka Lake for that matter. But anyway, Dillard wrote about how Mr. Parks would buy things at his store, like rabbits, that people, particularly young people, would hunt and trap. When he collected, and this just, I wouldn't have wanted to have gone into this room. Seems as though, I guess the rabbit, well, I'm just going to read it. I'm not going to tell you anything that I don't really know. When he collected a big bunch of bunnies, he'd sell the carcasses as hog feed. Okay. Glad I didn't bring it up. This was back in the days when cash money was rare and the old-fashioned swap was common for small business transactions. So for each rabbit, Parks would pay a rabbit check. People would save rabbit checks, trade them, and later redeem them at Parks' store for goods that they needed. Now, she says they were brass, and they were shaped like a stop sign, but the word here is incorrect. They put hexagonal, which should be octagonal, eight-sided, unless stop signs have changed shape since 1983. And it said TAP on it because this guy's name was Thomas A. Parks. There must have been a bounty of bunnies in the area, too. Dillard wrote that it was not unusual for the store to buy 60 to 100 rabbits in a day's time. So I don't know if bunnies are extinct out there now or what, but so really the whole economy in a large extent was based on rabbit checks. These things went out all over, Mrs. Groves said. There must be a lot of these rabbit checks lying around. Well, there may be more. Some of you may have even seen them. Some of you may have them. But this, what you see in the frame, and what you see around my neck are the rabbit checks that our family still has. Now, a few years ago for Christmas, this one has a value of $1. So that must have been for several bunnies that somebody brought in. But there, we had three of these with this shape. And so I went to a jewelry store in Jasper, and I thought that would be something nice to have made for my brother and my dad and myself. So they, I didn't want any holes drilled, of course, so they made a little frame around it, did some little clamps, and so now we can wear them around our necks if we choose to. So that's kind of the story on the rabbit checks. I have four pictures here of one-room schoolhouses in Jackson Township. This red sheet lists all of the schools in 1925 that would have been in Jackson Township. So there were certainly more than four. In the album, you will see a variety of pictures that I've collected from the family. Some of them are postcards, some of them are from family photos, and then the wallet that I brought was actually my great-grandfather's wallet, his leather wallet. So love to have known how much money flowed through that at one time or another. So that's about all I, oh, and then there is a picture there in the book of what, a drawing of what his store looked like. So basically that's what I can tell you. But my grandmother Lane, Maud Alice Parks Lane, grew up in Newton Stewart. There's a picture hanging on the post that I brought under the word creek. That's their home, where she and her parents and her eight brothers and sisters lived. And that was painted for me from a postcard image by a friend of mine. So the last occupants of that home were Jim and Dora Denbo, which some of you may have heard of. So as I say, after my great-grandfather Thomas Parks passed away in 1920 from the flu epidemic at age 62, then the store, as I understand it, went to his son Omer Parks, who then sold it. I'm not real sure on the ownership. You guys may know about more about that than I do, but I think at one time Omer Osborne owned it.
Yes, he did.
I don't know if it was before or after.
After.
After, okay. And at some point then the Riley family bought it, and then it, did this burn?
No.
No. Then the Rileys built a smaller building than uphill, or I guess that would be west, and that building is still standing there at, what would that be?
It's Newton Stewart Ramp.
Newton Stewart Ramp, okay, okay. Which I think they use for equipment or things, you know, mowing equipment. So my dad and I have walked out there in the roadbed before, and he actually identifies a tree, an evergreen tree, that was in his Uncle Omer's front yard. So it's even still there. So even after all the buildings were removed, he was able to see that. So I don't know, history's always been a big part of our family. And so we, I'm sort of obviously the historian, and my brother really doesn't care. So I guess I'm kind of, I'm really actually pretty happy about that, because then I get everything. So, so it works out in my favor. So, yes.
Is that the store where the funny slides was upstairs?
Correct. Yes.
There's a bit, I don't know if that's the one that was out at the current Newton Stewart Lodge or not. I know we have one on the wall.
We do? Okay.
So that may have been
I don't know.
They got there because Lita was a member of Eastern Star.
Okay. There are two more communities that I discovered were in that, roughly in that area. One was called Obi.
Never heard of that one.
And then another one called, of course, here in Southern Indiana, we mispronounce it, but we call it Iuka, but it was Iuka, I-U-K-A. Both of those had post offices, and I did some research, and it tells that they had post offices. It tells what year the post offices were in existence. May even tell who the postmasters were, but Obi and Iuki. I think one of them was near where he said Baseline Road crosses there, where Fern, Dad called her Fern Draving, but it was Fern Cave, finally. One was in that area near Jess Leitner's store, and then one was over by King Creek Church.
Now that was a flip on that house up there. Fern Cave was raised there.
What's that?
King Creek replaced that in Rico.
Iuki?
Yeah.
Really?
That was King Creek originally.
So
later.
King Creek, before it was called King Creek, was Iuki.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the way I got it from my
interesting.
Mr. Lane?
Yes.
Elon applied for a post office and couldn't get it because there's another town up north called Eat.
Also.
But that store there, that general store, may have been a post office there, could have been one of those names.
Good
at the time, but I don't know. I just throwing that in.
Greg Morris did bring pictures in the album on the round table of basically where you are right now, roughly, because his, where'd he go?
Where's Greg?
There he is. You say, your dad built this actual building here. And he said they had a sandstone home. I guess that would be north. And so he can tell you more about that album if you want to know anything about that. Okay, Howard, I guess it's your turn.
Well, I can tell you a lot, I guess, but I came here basically just to tell about the haunting of the old Cap Swift house. Now, I'm a product of German Catholics and Scotch-Irish Protestants, and they didn't really practice their religion in the time that I grew up, but I became associated first at Christian Church at Elon, but I have, I'm a descendant of the original, the first owner of any property in Jackson Township, and he had already built an undershoot water mill up up in Greenfield on Patoka, and I had a picture here of that, and a later picture of some wedding party under the works of the old dam and the original building, which this picture shows in relief. And my great-grandfather on my, that was on my paternal side, on my maternal side, he moved to machinery in the 20s up here into an old building up the river, or up the street from the Osborne, as I always knew it, store that Mr. Lane was talking about. And the cemetery was right behind there. And anyway, he came into the ownership of the Cap Swift property, and telling you a little bit about the Cap Swift property, Captain Swift was the officer in charge of the Jackson Township contingent to the Civil War. And I had my grandmother's father was a first aide to General Grant during that war, and his wife died giving birth to my grandmother, and she was, her mother gave her to her father, and he gave her to his son to raise with his children. And at any rate, that's some of my background. But I came to live in this Cap Swift house, which is depicted in this picture here. It's a New England style house, had about 14 rooms, including the halls and the attics. And the Morgan Ross came into there when Cap Swift lost his, when he came back, he brought a Negro with him that had taken care of his horse in bivouac area for his equipment and so on during the Civil War. And he wouldn't leave the Cap whenever the war was over, he'd come home with him. And he was his jockey, because Cap liked to cut ice on the rivers and have mint juleps and race his horses during the summer on a field my granddad owned, it called a horse race field between Elon and Newton. Actually, between granddad's farm, the three farms was about halfway between Elon and Newton Stewart and the Patoka Bottoms and up on the ridge. Granddad raised his five daughters in a two-room house. My dad lost his dad when he was 14 to pneumonia, and he came to work for, from a large family, he came to work for the Morgan Ross, and granddad, and he built, converted a brooder house to a bunk house, and then by and by he married my mother, which is a second from the right on this photo. And this shows me as a little fella with my granddad and grandma, because I was grandpa's boy, more or less, was with him in the field before I was even out of diapers, and later on an old steel wheel tractor. But anyway, he was born in 1890 in Du Bois County around Snellville. His dad, George, was the son of a Fidelis Morgan Roth that was with Sherman on his march to the south. And when Cap Swift was lost his farm in a gambling deal. He had discovered that his jockey had thrown the race for a bribe. And he had, his only son had already died, and he had willed a farm, but he had to take it back. And these sons were, grandsons were with him when he confronted the Negro, and the Negro admitted that he had thrown the race. So the captain pulled out a revolver and shot him and told him to bury the fella. When they dug up the graves at the Swift Cemetery back up on the ridge, I've got a plot of it. All of them were within a fenced area facing the east, except one on a catty corner outside the fence facing southwest, northeast. And I think that's where the Negro was buried. But anyway, that farm came into the Negro, the Morgenroth family, when George bought the Swift place, this lady here, this little picture hanging on the wall, is a childhood picture of his second wife. His first wife had died, granddad's mother died, his dad advertised for a woman, and she came and agreed to marry him, and then sent for her adult daughter, but stepdaughter rather, and her name was Naomi, and her husband's name was Walter Pulaski. And he had a emphysema or something of the lungs. He was slowly dying, couldn't be cured at the time. And she was much younger than he, and developed a relationship with a young bachelor school teacher that lived in a house between Elon from the Newton or the Swift place and Newton Stewart, about halfway between there. And Rome Kirby's wife was named Bridget Hughes before she married Rome. She told me who the name of the fellow was, but I declined to name it, but who it was. But anyway, he was a young fellow, and they developed a relationship. And the old man, and I'm running through this briefly, the old man developed a jealousy. He just wore a union suit in this big old house, and walking the floors and the stairs and the halls, and wasn't able to get out and do any work. And one day when she fixed the basket to go see her boyfriend, he followed her and picked up shotgun over the door and followed her out to the barnyard gate, where he caught up with her, and they had a confrontation, and he didn't have no shells, so he hit her over the head with the shotgun and split her scalp off and held down over her ears. She went off down the road with her mother helping her and crying and screaming going on. And to start with, I guess I'm getting a little ahead of myself. As I grew up, there were some things happening that just wasn't normal, but I didn't know it then. I didn't realize it till after I was assigned to my permanent unit at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, in the service, and got to thinking about, that's not normal. So I got back in time before grandmother died to ask her some questions. And she tells me at this time that this happened, she said, I don't believe in ghosts, but I'll tell you what I know. And so she said, me and the girls was over on the north side of the house in the orchard picking apples. It was late in the fall, cool weather. And my Aunt Mary, my mother's oldest sister, said, I run over there where I could see what all the commotion was about, and said, this old guy in a white suit come walking down, and the women's coming up through the hill there, and he pulled up and shot, and said, I just fell backwards, threw my hands out, and fell backwards on the ground. Grandma said the buckshot sprinkled down in the leaves on the other side of the house where they were picking the apples. And the women come up there, and they got the sheriff involved, and they got her to a hospital. And the sheriff formed a posse, and my two oldest uncles was old enough to be recognized by the sheriff to be on the posse. And he told me, Uncle Sam told me, he said, we searched for days and never found no sign of him. And he said that sheriff one time jerked out his gun and started shooting at quail, said he got a hit. He could have killed somebody. You know, I'm telling you what I was told. This is a story, word of mouth. And Anyway, Granddad told me that he said I finally found him about a week later, and we found him in the bottoms where there was a spit of land that was very sandy in those bottoms where they left it a drag setting and didn't plant it. A lot of horse weeds, if you know what a horse weed was, it's a huge ragweed, grew up very thick around there, and they hadn't went through that. But Granddad said I found him there, and we could tell he lived several days because of his business off to the side, but he just had a union suit on and he died of exposure. Well, he wasn't seen by Catholic priests, so they wouldn't accept him, and all the folks around the community got together and buried him in the, right out in the corner of the Eland Cemetery. So his remains is down here in the Memorial Cemetery somewhere. But anyway, whenever she come back from the hospital, Grandma said that she had her mother there, and then there was another relative, and she gave up the bed upstairs and made her a pallet down at the bottom of the stairway where we had the kitchen table as I grew up. And as I grew up, when we would sit down at supper time, that door would sound, you could hear the latch, like the door, somebody was turning the door latch from the inside. But prior to that, you'd hear big steps, just like some dad always said a great big heavy rooster was walking. But he would take a flashlight and shine it against the door facing and turn the knob and wait. And when the steps would come around, he'd jerk the door open, he'd never see nothing. But when we'd sit down to meal, that door would do that and slip open a little bit. And I can remember jumping up as a little fella and running and said, "You old ghost, leave the door shut." And you'd hear this stepping, like this, and then stop at the bottom of the stairwell. It'd start at the top of the stairwell, and it'd go around the hall up there, and you wouldn't hear it. After a while, you'd hear it downstairs under the stairwell from that bedroom coming around to the bottom of the steps. Well, it was something me and my siblings grew up with and didn't think anything about it till I was in the service, you see. Anyway, Grandma said when they came that night when she was first back, she built a fire in the kitchen stove because it was late in the fall and made her a pallet on the floor. And she went to screaming and scared everybody and got down there, and they said she told them that Walter was standing there at the foot of her bunk looking at her. And they said she left and nobody ever heard from her again. Her stepmother didn't know where she went. Some of them had said she went to Europe. Some of them said she went west. But The other incident that someone saw an apparition was an uncle. My oldest aunt's husband lived in Louisville, and he was an avid hunter and a fisher, and he's back from World War II. And he come down there to go squirrel hunting with Dad, and they'd stay all night, and Dad put him in the bed upstairs at the head of the stairwell. And he said when the first night that happened, and it wasn't, but that one, he said that Coffee come stumbling and down the stairwell, was yelling and run into his bedroom and grabbed his hands so white as a sheet and said, "Tommy, there's somebody standing at the foot of my bed and I can see through him, and he's looking at me." Dad said he sat there and held his hand the rest of the night till he would never come back down there anymore. So I assume that Walter Pulaski wasn't at rest and that he was wandering the area. He never caused no harm, but you know, ghosts never do. People harm themselves out of fear. Some lady, I told this over at the visitor center one time, and some lady said, "Well, I don't believe in ghosts." And I said, "Do you believe in God?" She said, "Yeah." And I said, "Then you have to believe in ghosts. There are spirits that I think aren't at rest, but they can't do anything. The scripture says there's a great gulf fixed between those places and here." Anyway, that's basically my story, and I've kind of hurried from it because I I think other people might want to tell their story.
I like Howard. My mom and dad told me stories and just went through one ear and out the other.
Sure.
My dad was born on Painter Creek in 1895. And he helped. He was contracted when they built the road through here. Well, he was contracted with his team of mules for the bridge over Patoka River out here. He was contracted to help, you know, drag some stuff around, you know, whatever. And he lived long enough to see it tore down for the lake when the lake went in.
Now, my granddad talked about doing the same thing. They pay their taxes by hauling rocks and have slats in the bottom of the wagons they could pull out and drop the rocks on the ground, and they beat them up with sledgehammers. Yeah. And that's how they got paid their taxes a lot. And
a lot of things that, you know, everybody's got the wrong idea. The Narrows, all the educated people call them the Narrows.
The Narries.
Yeah, the same thing with Painter Creek. Originally in Orange County, early Orange County history, it was called Panther Creek.
Panther.
Yeah, okay. Because they were panthers in this area, the black collar phase of the cougar.
Wow.
In those times.
So it really, that is true then, because I thought that was just misspelled.
No.
So it was Panther Creek. Well, it wouldn't have been Panther Creek. It would have been Panther Creek.
Yeah. Yeah. But the same thing happened with Patoka. They called it Padoki. That was local lingo.
Aren't there two bridges that they were not able to remove under Patoka before it flooded?
There's an old concrete bridge south of Elon that went north, and it wasn't removed. And I don't think the old iron bridge at Elon was ever removed.
Okay. But the Newton Stewart Bridge was?
Yes.
Okay.
I remember coming down through that valley after everybody was gone, and it was just before they flooded it. There was snow on it. And I'll always remember the picture of how eerie that was. The animal tracks in the snow and across the road.
Of course, the last book that Arthur Dillard wrote, it has quite a bit of information in it too about Newton Stewart, because the Dillard family was.
Yeah, he mentions the Morgenroth family coming through with their retinue, I think that's the way he said it. All of their wagons and all of their furniture and all of their animals driving them, coming by his place when they went to occupy the Swift place.
Wow.
And he mentioned it in that book, I think, one of them.
Now, that Captain Swift that you mentioned, was he the man who had the big racetrack?
Yeah, William T. Smith.
Okay.
He preferred to be called Cap after he came back. Yeah, everybody called him Cap Grandage said.
Have you ever heard a story? Dora told me this also about the White Caps.
The White Caps.
The White Caps and Newton Stewart.
They would give fellas that was mistreating their family really good lickings.
Well, she told me, and she didn't tell me who any of them were, because she said they still have relatives living.
Oh, yeah.
But she said you could tell when they were having a meeting. I mean, it'd just be like us now. They recognized their horses.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, we would recognize our cars now. But they would meet in the evening around somebody's barn, and they would decide who, you know, was not behaving properly, and they would leave a bundle of switches, she said, on their doorstep. And if they didn't straighten up, then they would take them out at some point and use them on.
But the Ku Klux Klan was pretty strong in Indiana at one time.
Okay.
That was the White Caps.
Okay. So another name for the Klan. Okay.
I'll tell you another story. My grandfather Lewis, that died with the pneumonia, had been a blacksmith and a circuit preacher, and they'd lived over in the edge of Davis County for a while where my dad was born. And he said he preached at a little church over there and said there wasn't no money. The women brought their children, but the men wouldn't come to church. Seldom ever saw a man in church. But he said one Sunday when there wasn't no money and the door opened in the back, and one of them come in and covered with his sheet and stood in the door. Another one come in and went up, and they come in lines. And every one of them laid a dollar down and went out the side door with somebody opening the door and standing there till they all gone out, and then they just disappeared. He said that story comes down through the family that he got paid that way one time. And that would have been in the 20s. I'd say there was probably the early 30s, late 20s or early 30s.
Okay. Wow. Bill, you had some.
Well, this little switch, but a few years ago, Fisherman's Liars Contest was won by a fisherman who said that the fishing was so bad in Painter Creek that not even the worst liar caught anything.
One short story, my
first
wife was born down near Birdseye. Her father was raised in this whole area, had a farm down on Pedora School Road, just below the entrance to the lake. And wife's father-in-law had given them a team of mules when they were married, and Levi, his name is Levi Andre, and he was a little short on patience with those mules, but she could handle them no problem. She could walk out there and take all those mules and do anything she wanted to with them. Well, he was dragging some logs out of the woods to the sawmill with him, and he unhitched to go get another hitch on them, and the mules run away from him. And they went way back the lane, and they got caught on a small sapling, and then one of them was one side, one on the other, and they're all tangled up. And they finally settled down, and he was just beside himself. And she said, "Now, if you'll promise to not whip them mules, I'll go up there and get them for you, but I'm not going to go get them if you're going to whip them when you bring them back."
Well, the only thing I remember that my father, every fall, would take a bunch of wheat to Elon to have it cleaned. And I thought it was head on South Eggerty Y, is where I thought it was. But I'm not sure of it.
I think it was a little north of Newton Stewart.
When is it?
Elon.
Elon, yeah.
Yeah, it would have been Newton Stewart is in Orange, so.
You go west on the county road and intersect the road up there that went north to Elon. And now.
Well, wasn't there a feed mill there?
Not seed cleaning? At Newton Stewart there was.
Yeah.
Do you remember the mill ever running in Newton Stewart?
No.
But I think he told me that the Elon mill had been dismantled and moved to French Lick.
Well, he took his seed wheat every year, grew his own wheat, and took his planted his own grain, and he took it there to have it cleaned.
Now,
when I was a kid,
I didn't grow up in the country. Explain to me how you would clean wheat.
Well, you run through a fanning process.
So that would just get everything out that you didn't want.
Got all your chaff and all your onion seeds and seeds out of it.
What you call separating the wheat from the chaff.
Okay.
It was a series of shakers and air.
Okay. I see.
And you run through this mill.
That does make sense.
And blend out all this stuff.
Well, folks, we've had a wonderful time today. It's coming up on our hour of ending, and I know that our host and hostess for the day would like to get cleaned up after we leave. So we want to thank them so much for allowing us to come here to the Painter Creek. And we want to remind you that the Painter Creek Cafe is open every day, 7 days a week from 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. So please come back and patronize them for hosting us today. It's a lovely, lovely little restaurant. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you. So we're going down, right? We're going down. We're going down there to see them.
There have been several. Yeah.
They've got original archive. I knew her. I was taught by her husband when I was somewhere between first and fifth grade. There's a sign up here that says Prairie Rose Walking Flower.
For me to do that is some of the common
sandstone lids are behind her, and then got around to putting it on the roof and a fire flew.
What year did the fire happen?
It would have been in the mid 50s.
Uh huh.
Or not mid 50s, mid 40s.
Mid 40s, okay.
Yeah.